Alright guys, so at this point you're already pretty good at determining the equilibrium for an acid-base reaction if you have the pKa information. So I already taught you that you would compare the pKa of the acid and the conjugate acid, you would see which one's stronger and weaker, and that would determine your equilibrium. But what if you don't have pKa information? So what if you have an acid-base equilibrium question and there are two compounds that you just don't know the pKa's for? Or there's other situations too where pKa information might not be that helpful. And that's when we're going to use the factors affecting acidity, okay? So for the next few pages, what I'm going to do is I'm going to introduce five factors that, even without knowing pKa values, we can still tell which one's going to be more acidic and less acidic based on these factors. So let's go ahead and get started. So as I mentioned, there's five major factors, and we're really going to use these factors in two different situations, okay? The first situation is that pKa information is unavailable for a molecule. So what that means is that maybe you didn't memorize it, or maybe your professor didn't give it to you, or maybe you did memorize it and you just forgot it. Hey, if you're at a test and you don't remember it, it's unavailable, all right? So then we might want to use factors affecting acidity. A second instance would be if the pKa's of two molecules are too similar to make a determination of highest acidity. So imagine if you're comparing two carboxylic acids. Well, they're both going to have the pKa of around 5. So how do I tell which one's more acidic and which one's less acidic? Well, with pKa information, you wouldn't really be able to do that. So we're going to need to look even more in depth into these acids. Okay? So whenever we're analyzing these five different factors, what we're going to do is, instead of looking at the acid, we're actually going to look at something else, and that's going to be the stability of the conjugate base, okay? How does this work, okay? Well, the reason we look at the stability of the conjugate base is because that's going to tell us how willing the molecule is to give away a proton. So the more stable the conjugate, the more willing the acid is going to be to donate a proton. How does that make sense? Well, remember, the conjugate base is what the acid becomes after it reacts, okay? If the conjugate base is very, very stable, then it's going to say, hey, I'm fine giving up a proton as an acid, because if I give up a proton, I'm just going to be this really nice, stable conjugate base. Awesome, all right? But what if the conjugate base sucks? How about if it's just like the worst conjugate of life? It's not going to want to exist very much, okay? So instead, it's going to say, hey, I'd rather stay as the acid and have the proton on myself. So basically, the dissociation constant, the likelihood of me giving up a proton, is going to increase as my conjugate base becomes more and more stable. Does that make sense? And that's what these five effects have to do with. They are going to either increase the stability or decrease the stability of the conjugate base. All right?